Father, so wonderful. His life is so glorious. And it's so sad. The blind, mind-blinding spirits of darkness, the realms of the demonic that hide this realm of God's goodness and joy and His love from the hearts of men. You know, if it was just that, it's a choice that is made, and if you choose not to serve God, well, then you die and it's over. But it's far more urgent than all of that. It's far more consequential, because hell is a real place. In many ways, it's more real, if it's possible to be more real, than what you're experiencing right now. Why? Because this is temporal. This is the place where God sorts through men to find out who wants to walk with Him, because He's not going to force anyone. And it's not like God created hell for men. He created it for the devil and his angels. And God never meant man to be a part of that rebellion. He never meant it. He never intended it. People want to make it as though God intended it. But He didn't. There's nothing to prove that God intended that. He put man that He had made and fashioned and formed in His own image and likeness. And you can't have a better start than that. It's just impossible. You cannot have a better start than that. You cannot be more fully endowed, more fully equipped, more fully empowered than to be shaped in His image and His likeness, to be created in every dimension of His holiness, to have His presence there, to be placed in the midst of His paradise, heaven, literally, in the midst of His heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm getting ready to do a book on the millennial reign of Christ. And for me, the picture of what God's going to do just in the restoration of during the millennial reign looks like the paradise of the Garden of Eden. So I have a great template to go off of. What He's going to do in the new heaven and the new earth. Wow. I don't want to miss out on that. I don't want to see anyone miss out on that. Father doesn't want anyone to miss out on that. Men have to rebel against God, fight against God by coming into allegiance with something that is easy to slip into within the culture of our society, especially in the Western world, of the pride of life, of what each individual believes is true. And if they could just stop and take a moment and step back and look at themselves, if they could write a book about their life and what they believe, after having written that book, they would be convinced that they are completely wrong. They would close the book and maybe burn it. Men don't think clearly enough and deeply enough about the consequences of their life, the way that they've lived. The many witnesses and the many proofs that are around us of God's mercy, the reproducibility of this so great a salvation, because it is not about a belief. It's not about an ideology or philosophy. It is about a change of heart. It is about a change of spirit. It is about a change of nature that can only happen through the miracle provision of God. A miracle provision. Listen to me. Listen to me. Listen. A miracle provision. A miracle that He grants for us through the name of His only begotten Son, Jesus. A miracle that God wants you to grab a hold of because He wants you to become addicted to reaching the lost. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, some of the heroes of the kingdom are here today with us from Overland's Mission. I believe every one of you are heroes in the kingdom, no matter where you're serving. So long as you're serving, you ministers of the gospel. Did you know that? There's no such thing as volunteers. And, you know, it's just, you know, we just all in Christ and He's in us. And wow, is that ever a leveling ground? And the greatest among us, you can spot them a long ways off. They servants of all. Huh? And the least among us think that they lord over everything. You know what I'm saying? Hey, Michelle, why don't you come and introduce everybody? Just come here and let everybody meet Michelle. Because her sister and brother-in-law is going to be here pretty soon. Yeah, they are. So come here. And then you just tell everybody what's going on, what you're doing.
Hi, my name is Michelle, and that's Shannon right there.
and sets in. And
have them come up too. And, yeah, and they bring the, you guys, all you come up, just letting you lead the way.
So we are all expedition leaders with Overland Missions. And in Zambia, Africa, Tanzania, Cambodia, Myanmar, the Philippines, Brazil. And so we are traveling around recruiting people to come on mission trips with us. And God is just moving in incredible ways in the nations, like right now. And the harvest is wide open. And God is just looking for people to come with us. And it's just great and exciting times that we're living in. And just revival is breaking out everywhere we go. And it's just exciting to see. It's exciting to be a part of, and we're so thankful to be with you guys, and yeah.
It's beautiful. You just passed the mic. I want everybody to tell what you're doing.
Awesome.
Especially, we're saving Congo for last over there.
So my name is Shannon. I'm also an expedition leader like Michelle and Stetson, and my biggest thing that I'm gonna tell you guys is the nations are ready to know about Jesus, and they just need someone to go tell them. They need someone to go preach the gospel to them, and doors everywhere are open, even in places where the gospel shouldn't be preached because of their laws or their culture. That doesn't matter, because our God is bigger, and he goes past borders, and he goes beyond cultures, and like this year in Cambodia, we just saw such breakthrough, and like, we were doing things that were illegal, but God was, he was on our side. And he was like, no, like, I got you. You're my children. And so are they. They're my lost children, and I want them. And so just know, like, the nations are ready for a move of God. And we're going to see that, because it's already begun, and it's an exciting thing. And so go out and preach, guys.
Amen. Yeah, I'm Stetson. I'm also an expedition leader with Overland Missions. This will be my last year in that role. I'm transitioning to moving to the Congo full-time, which is super exciting, not because in the natural I'm drawn to the Congo, but because the Lord is moving there, and he has placed such a prophetic call and confirmation on our team there, and just has poured out his favor on the whole process. There's been some stumbling blocks, not stumbling blocks, just speed bumps along the way. We had, you know, one of our best friends and contacts there has passed away this year. Just some, you know, the enemy's coming against it just because he knows there's a mighty move coming there. But the things that the Lord has done there has been far greater. And this year we had, as Pastor Mark mentioned in the morning service earlier, we had Emperor Mwantyov of the Lunda Empire in Africa, super historic people group, one of the most famous empires of the history of Africa. He came and visited our base in Zambia from the Congo, took the 3-day trek down there to spend the week listening to Pastor Mark and some of the other ministers there, just getting poured into with the Word of God. Now, there had been paramount chiefs from all over Zambia who each are over hundreds of thousands of people who are underneath this guy or from other people groups who have been trying to get the emperor to come to Zambia for years. He's declined every invitation until Overland Missions invited him to our guest ministers week. And I want to tell you that everyone sensed that the heavens were trembling at that moment, that things are being prepared in the Congo because he loves his people there, and he's preparing a violent advance to go and take the nations for the kingdom, and just things, amazing things are being put on our hearts. But I just want to say that my word to you is that a lot of times we in the church feel like we have a red light until God gives us a green light. But in the kingdom, we have a green light until God gives us a red light. I didn't feel like, oh, God has called me to Zambia for the rest of my life. Therefore, I'm going to the specific nation of Zambia. You know, if you look in the New Testament, There are few, if any, almost no examples of the Lord saying, you will go to this specific location now. That I'm not saying that doesn't happen. I'm saying if you're waiting on that for your call to missions, then you're neglecting the original call that was given right here. And once you steward that call, then you'll be given more specifics. The Congo was dropped as a very simple seed in my heart in the beginning. I didn't know if it was me and my adventurous spirit or if it was God. And it was just something that I had to put on the shelf for years. And I served the call that was given in this book. And I went to Zambia despite not knowing, like, you know, which nation. God said go into the nations, into all the world. So I went to Zambia, served the vision of Overland Missions for a few years there. And then God began to bring back not only opportunities to go into the Congo, but just prophetic visions and prophecies from people who didn't know anything about it, and just confirmations and dreams and everything needed, and just all these crazy doors opening up with the emperor that's just going to pave the way for us, as well as other connections. And I just want to say, you have a green light. You have been given a voice that is endued with the very power of God inside of you. You have the DNA of Jesus Christ, and you have the call to get out there and do something about it. Amen.
You know, Jacob was saying that when you guys were laying the plan out before the emperor, that he said, this is the last great thing I can do for my people. When they're laying out the plan of having a pastor, as it were, a minister, they're associated with each chieftain in each region of the entire Congo. Am I getting this right? Here the emperor said, I mean, this is just his story. It's what they're going to write books about, man. I mean, come on. It's true. This is the last great thing I can do for my people. This is amazing. And, I mean, Texas, just outside of Dallas, yeah. Tucson, Arizona, New Mexico. Come on, people. You know, you don't have to live in a particular spot. Really, reality of it is, Overland Missions are dear to hearts. We're partners with them. We're part of an alliance with them. If you want to go to the mission field, talk to them. They'll get you all hooked up and straightened out on what to do. And you either got to go there for a while or you got to go somewhere that I'm going, okay? And they got more of a structure and help. I'm just going to drop you and say, get her done, okay? So, amen. We love you guys. Come on, everybody. Give them a good shout. Praise God. You want to say anything else? Anything else? Don't prophesy. Say anything else?
Go into the nations.
There you go.
Just go into the nations.
Hey, man. You know, being addicted to reaching the lost. I mean, we're going to talk some things tonight about how to just grab a hold of that, how to begin to allow fellowship with the Lord to nurture within your heart the compassion that Father has for every man. You know, God's not willing that anyone perish. But mark these words of God, because not one of his words shall fail. If you do not let him change your nature, if you reject so great a salvation, and really the Lord even put it even on a more severe note. He said, if you neglect so great a salvation, you shall surely perish. That is so tragic that men would reject and neglect something so wonderful that Father has done for us. And I pray that you'll begin to enjoy what he's given, so that as you delight in him and are overwhelmed by him, a great compassion and burden for the lost will begin to fill you. And you, in that wonderful commitment and consecration and addiction to reaching the lost, because I mean, when you start seeing devils go out, people being transformed by the power of God. And I know it seems so hard and so difficult in the United States of America. But you know, I voted for the person. I said, Lord, I want to vote for the person that's going to bring America to its knees the quickest. And I prayed that way, and I believe that's exactly what happened. And that there's going to be a wide open door of opportunity. And right here tonight, we're getting prepared to bring in a great harvest in the United States. There's going to be a great harvest in the United States of America, in Switzerland, in Sweden, in Germany, in Spain, in France, and all the Western world. Hallelujah. So, Joshua, could you just do one more song? Just worship. Let's just worship one more song. And I hate to stop worshiping ever anyways. And I just say, you know, just say, Lord, your praise shall continually be in my mouth. Yes. Say it. Say, Lord.
Lord.
Your praise.
Your praise.
Shall be continually in my mouth.
I shall bless the Lord at all times.
Lord, you just talk, you say to him, he's put these words in your mouth. These are my words. Lord, I will bless you at all times. Your praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in thee, Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Hallelujah. I can't hear you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you,
overwhelmed by your praise.
Overwhelmed
by your praise. Overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence.
Taken with your love.
Overwhelmed by your presence.
Thank you, Jesus. Lord Jesus. We're overwhelmed by you, Lord.
Overwhelmed by your presence. Lord Jesus. Overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence. Now rejoice in your life.
Lord Jesus,
overwhelmed by your presence, overwhelmed by your presence, overwhelmed by your presence, overwhelmed by your praise. So I'll rejoice in your love. Oh, I'll rest in your peace and delight in your joy. Oh, I'll rejoice in your love. And I'll rest in your peace. Overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence.
You know, this is what the Lord wants to say to you. Every one of you who sought him, those of you who cried out to him to be used by him, the things that Father's about to do through you is he makes you 10,000 times more. So he makes you 10,000 times more. So he uses you to reach it 10,000 times more. Is the days that are before you are days of greatness and days of glory and days of splendor. What Father is about to reveal, the manifest glory of his presence, of his person, he's about to reveal through us. Listen, when we leave this world, we will step into a realm and a place of beholding him face to face. But when the resurrection of the body takes place, and we're raised up together with him, immortal, incorruptible in the heavens. And I want to say this for those of you maybe that don't understand. When you die, the real you, the eternal you, the inward you, the one that we call the inner man or the spirit and the soul, the inward person, departs from your body. And the scripture tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that we're not naked or that we're not barren of a tabernacle, but we have a tabernacle prepared by him in the heavens. So that, you know, you're not something less than what you are now, you're something more than what you are now, if you can begin to understand that. And as we there in this time period wait for the resurrection of the body, where our body is raised up like his glorious body, just like he was raised up immortal, incorruptible, eternal in the heavens, so we are going also. At that moment in time, the splendor of his glory that is going to be revealed through our lives during the millennial reign, throughout the eternal glory of heaven, what we call the eternal perfect earth. And I'm going to tell you right now, for those people who are calling out to God, there's not one prayer that was offered up before him that he did not hear. There was not one request to be used by him that he disregarded. No. Father is preparing a people that are going to do great exploits, great signs and wonders, great miracles, that are going to step into a place of relationship with him and walking with him. Yes, amen. So that the Son, Christ Jesus, might be revealed. And I want to just help you understand some dimensions of this and what you're going to have to be willing to do to participate with what God's purpose to do. Praise you, the Lord. Sing unto the Lord a new song. Tomorrow's a new day and you're going to have to sing a new song. Yeah. Father wants to hook you up with something I'm going to talk to you about tonight. And at some time you're going to have to start practicing, because I've heard people say for years they're going to start doing it and they never began. And there can't be anything easier for you than to smile and say, thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Shouldn't be anything more difficult. Praise him in the congregation of the saints. I mean, if there's anything God's people are going to have to start doing, is letting the Holy Spirit develop them to where that they get really excited about who he is. Every time Father talks about how we're supposed to interact with him, he talks about something that is deep in our passions, deep in our emotions. He uses words like heart. He uses words like bowels. He uses words that describe the deepest depths of our being, spirit, soul. And as God's people begin to delight themselves in him, begin to praise him, begin to interact with him, something glorious is going to begin to happen. The fire of God is going to begin to be manifested around you. I'm telling you, I tell you right now, it's amazing to me how that somehow people think that the influence of the demonic, even in families, there's a lost husband or a lost wife, the other one serving God, and somehow they think that the influence of the demonic will be in greater impact than the influence of God, the Holy Ghost. They just never started praising. They never started praising. Their God never became God manifested through their life. He said, let Israel rejoice in him that made him. Let the children of Zion, that's you and me, be joyful in their king. Let them praise his name. Let them praise his name in the dance. I tell you, sometimes I can dance. Sometimes the Holy Ghost takes me to a place and it's like, you know, it's like, my wife said one time, she's watching right now, I never knew you could do that. In fact, I didn't know anyone could do that. You're right at the point of just kind of, you know, mounting up with wings for real. There is a realm that begins to be nurtured in your life. Those who've given yourself to praise, you praise far better than you did at first. Those that you begin to dance in the Lord, you dance far better than you did at first. Those that you have been baptized in the Holy Ghost, you know how to move with the wind of the Spirit and flow in the river of God. You do it a lot better than you did at first. Those that you have prophesied, oh, it comes much stronger than it did at first. Get started if you're not started. Get started tonight, because I'm telling you right now, a few years from now, it's going to look great. Get to dancing. Let them sing praises unto him with a timbrel and with a harp. You can be seated. I was listening to Eddie Boy today. In fact, I'm going to go. It looks like James and I are going to go meet with him. And, you know, Eddie Boy has the largest church in the history of the church right now in Nigeria. And everywhere he goes, he carries a tambourine. Because he wants everybody to know that he's never going to be too great or too big. His church is 1.8 miles wide and 1.8 miles long, and it's jam-packed inside, and there's people outside. He's the general overseer of the Church of God, carries the tambourine because he wants everybody to know he's never too great to worship God and praise him at any place and at any time. I mean, can you see this guy that everybody admires? I mean, presidents and great men and leaders of government come to see him. He's got his tambourine. Ha! Come on! Oh, sapara se! Set romande a casa rameata! And the beautiful thing of it is, he says it like so many people have said it before, that the word has said it over and over again. You want to step into the greatness of God, learn how to flow, learn how to praise him from the depths of your being. Learn how to give thanks, learn how to worship him. Learn how to dance, learn how to sing. Get yourself a tambourine. And of course, you know, so many people will get a tambourine. I saw some yellow tambourines in the congregation. But that's okay. They can do that. Imitating someone as they imitate. Because you know what Jesus is doing? He stands in the midst of the congregation singing praise. That's what he does. That's what he does. That's who he is. He's standing. Ooh, I guarantee you, you can't outpraise him as he worships the Father. Radical. Radical. Some of these people that believe that somehow God's not who he says he is, and they have a hard time understanding how Jesus is there in the midst of the congregation singing praise to the Father. But he is. Regardless of our ability to understand how and who God is. And how he works. Heck, listen. He's not interested in your intellect. He's interested in your heart. You know what? He's not interested in all that you know about him. He's interested in the kisses. You have to learn how to kiss him. He said, Simon, I came in. You didn't anoint my head with oil. But she anointed me with her tears. He said, you gave me no kiss. But she's not ceased to kiss my feet. Kiss me since she's walked in here. He's telling us. The Lord says, what do I want from you? Your love. I mean, in the great Decalogue, in the great discovery of who Father is, he describes himself as the one who's so merciful, full of compassion and loving kindness, full of truth and goodness, who wants us to love him with all of our heart. Wow. I mean, there's no story written of all the rest of the gods that are vanity are all just nothing but a bunch of stories of manipulation and terror and rejection and separation, and he calls you and I to come in and enjoy all that he has. He's not threatened by oneness with us. He delights in it. And if you just spend time with us, is it going to get bigger? It's going to get bigger. I'm telling you right now. It's going to get bigger. This love and affection for all that he's done for us. And it is in that, that our declaration and proclamation of who he is becomes far more effective. And I'm telling you, you know, I know how imprisoned the Western world is with religion. I understand it. I mean, I've had to deal with it on a level that a lot of people haven't had to deal with. Most pastors have to deal with it because, you know, it's constantly threatening you. It's constantly intimidating you. It's constantly challenging you and tempting you to compromise, to do what people want you to do what religion demands. You stand and say, no, I'm going to stand here and I'm going to proclaim all these things of God. I'm going to talk about intimacy, change. I'm going to talk about glory. I'm talking about power. I'm talking about authority. I'm talking about the movings of the Holy Ghost, letting God, the Holy Ghost, be in charge. Yes. You know, I've listened to a lot of people talk about what they believe the main topics of the Bible are. And over and again, you know what they fundamentally, all of them in common, you know what they leave out? That God, the Holy Ghost, is over the church. They leave out the concept that God the Holy Ghost is the one who divides to every person, who is the authority that is sent to be with us and is supposed to be given the place of leadership among us, that we're supposed to give ourselves to doing everything that he's come to express through our life, that the Word of God describes is fundamentally common over and again. The enemy has done everything he possibly can do to stop us from going with the Holy Spirit, moving with God, to move into man-made programs. But if we will not back down, if we'll obey him, we'll learn how to flow with him. And he's the only one who can reveal Jesus. And when he's allowed free course to our life, I'm telling you, it is just a matter of time. This thing is melting. It's melting. It's like a wax. It's like a wax dummy melting in the sun of his presence. It's a mountain of hindrance that we're standing there prophesying and screaming, grace, grace to, and it's going to be moved out of the way. And those that didn't bend, those that didn't bow, huh? Those who didn't change or compromise, watch what God will do to them. Be glorious. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. Say, the Lord takes pleasure in me.
The Lord takes pleasure in me.
Not when you're murmuring and complaining. I want you to understand that. Yeah, be keeping it in the context. The Lord takes pleasure in me. Not when you're murmuring and complaining. We got other verses of scripture for that. Okay. He says, I swear in my wrath. You know, the two times the Lord sweared. He swore. Two times. One, when Abraham offered Isaac the best that he had. He gave that which was most dear to him, the most precious to him. Through that act of his faithfulness, God used a man to change the world. Not a nation, the world. Not a city, the world. Not a family, the world. Wow. A lot to say about that. But God said, see, as there's no one higher than me that I can swear by, I swear by myself, blessing you, I shall bless you. And increasing you, I shall increase you. Prospering, I shall prosper you. And then the other time was when the Lord said, I swear in my wrath, you shall not enter into my rest, though the work was done for the foundation of the world. Why? Because of their murmuring and complaining. But I tell you right now, when you begin to praise and give thanks, when you begin to enjoy the life that he's given to us, and now the more than abundant life, the provision of a wellspring, and more than a wellspring, a river, all the expression of the divine power of his glory, so that we can have everything that pertains to life and godliness and all the goodness and all the things that would cause us to give thanks anyways. If we're without them, then reality of it is we've not submitted ourselves to God. We've not submitted ourselves to the working of God and the manifest presence of God in our lives. Something's happened. We've made a disconnect. It's got to be fixed.
Amen.
And I believe that's a lot of what God, the Holy Ghost, is doing. He just prepares things. He's got time. He's not in a hurry. We're in a hurry. We're like, hurry up, we got to do it now. And we get all disappointed because we went out. And I'm just so proud of you. I'm so blessed by those of you who continually go to the streets and rejection upon rejection upon rejection upon rejection upon rejection. It's much easier on the mission field. Much easier because now it's acceptance after acceptance after acceptance. I mean, it's rewarding. I mean, I'm telling you right now, yeah. Ooh, if you can minister in America, all the rest of the world it's all downhill from there. I mean, it's just like, come on. It's picking fruit in a very fruitful place. But you know what? There's somebody who's got to contend for the nation. There's somebody who's got to contend for the hundreds of thousands, the millions, the hundreds of millions that are dying and going into an eternity without God. There's so many of the people that are committing suicide. They don't believe in, you know, they don't believe in God. You know what the result of them not believing in God is? Committing suicide. They bought into the lies of academia, the philosophies of men, and that is going to leave you one miserable person.
Amen.
Hopeless and miserable. And to go and reach them, to begin to have a word of life in your mouth, an authority of God in your spirit. My, where every yoke is broken off when you go to talking. People go to listening. They begin to be captivated by the presence of the Lord. And then you follow them home. You run them down and you bring them to the place. And there's no excuses. Because God's going to hold us accountable for that. And reality of it is, excuses is only an expression of our distance from Him. And this is the cure. This is the cure. So that you can get real close. As close as possible. When you begin to worship. If you want to, the Lord calls out, He says, if you want to draw nearer to me and get as close to me as you possibly can get, bring the offering and come worship at the door. We find ourselves with the offering, the lamb that the Lord provided for Himself. Christ Jesus. We find ourselves captivated in Him, raptured in Him. That's how the offering works. If I'm not captivated by Him, raptured in Him, if I'm not in Him and He's not in me, I'm not offering the offering, because that's what the lamb was. That's what all the various different sacrificial offerings were about. They became you, as it were, and you became them in a substitutionary, in a vicarious way. Only to try to speak of this life that God would give us, to where that our existence and our acceptance and our identity and who we are is all defined by who He is. And in acceptance of that, we find ourselves transfigured. We find ourselves growing and maturing and stepping into all that He supplies. Otherwise, we're always distanced, because all we can see is our failure. And all that failure and condemnation is going to say to us is, draw not nigh. So people are always trying to be reconciled, trying to be right, trying to get it right, trying to be loved, trying to be accepted. You are accepted, the beloved. You come and worship with the Lamb, Christ Jesus. You're in Him, He's in you. It's all about Him. You're like, wow, Jesus. You don't even see you anymore. Just Him. Somebody reminds you about you and you say, He's dead, He's crucified. I was preaching at a dear friend of mine's funeral, and he suddenly left this world January 3rd. Great preacher, great man of God, signs, wonders, and miracles. Died of a heart attack almost instantly. His heart exploded. He went into the realms of glory. There's no question about it. There's a lot of people who die with it instantaneously, and they lift up their eyes being in torment, a torment that will never cease. So sad, because they spent their life rejecting God's love, fighting against God, fighting against His provision, wanting to do it their own way. But at any rate, I'm preaching His funeral, and the power of God is moving in that place. And his sisters were on the front row, and I'd known him since we were 14 years old. And so all his sisters are trying to get me to guess who they are, because, you know, they were all little, you know. And I'm like, you're, the oldest, Maria, said, no, I'm not her. I'm the one that was used to short you guys out all the time. I said, that person no longer exists. She says, I know. I see. She's not even saved. Doesn't even know the Lord. I know I can see. That person no longer exists. Why? Because one day I simply said, I no longer exist. And I prophesy and praise and I'm thanksgiving to God and it becomes a living reality. I accept, I call upon Him and I believe what He said in His Word and it becomes a living reality. And I just obey Him and I choose His way. I watch over and again. I've seen, I'm 50, almost 58 years old now. I mean, I got crushed the other day. Somebody asked me if I wanted a senior's discount. I said, no. I don't care. Ed said, well, how much was it? I said, I didn't care if it was 100% off. I didn't want that thing. I was crushed. I said, do I look that bad? Senior's discount. No way. No way. What happened? Seniors, I mean, I was crushed. I was like, God, help me, heal me, heal me, heal me, and I shall be healed. But I've watched the people who've done it their own way. They harden their heart against God. I remember 22 years old, 23 years old, just going at it, just prophesying, crying out to people by the word of the Lord. Many of them are dead now in eternity without God. They wouldn't have listened. Those who aren't dead, their lives are miserable. Some of them have wealth, but they're full of sorrow on their second, third wife, on their second husband. Kids hate them. What's the difference between me and them? The only difference between me and them is I said, Lord, I'm going to do it your way. Whatever you say to do, I'm going to do it your way because your word brings life. What you declare will result in prosperity and blessing for me. I'm going to do your way. Hallelujah. Tonight, I'm just begging you by the Holy Ghost. God's begging you. Can you imagine? People think they're pleading with God. God's pleading with us. He's pleading with us. He's begging us to be made right. Because there's no way that God is ever going to have an agreement with the devil. There's no way that light will ever have an agreement with darkness. There's no way that truth will ever have an agreement with a lie, that death will ever have an agreement with life. Father's saying, choose life and live. Be a part of who I am. And men say, no, I want to be a part of darkness and death. Men love darkness because they love evil. The Lord doesn't make us. He pleads with us. It breaks His heart. He's done everything. He sacrificed everything. I mean, it was such an intensity. His intense hurt, as it were, in affection to see us redeemed, resulted in Him being blessed when He saw His only begotten Son chastised and crucified because He saw our redemption. It took the grieving and the sorrow, as it were, all away when He provided a redemption for us through Jesus. It's about time you just say, look, I'm dead. That person no longer exists. I'm in the offering. I'm offering up the sacrifice of praise. I'm in the offering. I'm in the place of worship. I'm giving forth this offering of the Lamb, the evening and the morning sacrifice. And I want to grab a hold of that for you. And I want you to get it. I want you to understand, you're giving yourself 10, 15 minutes in the morning, 10, 15 minutes in the afternoon or the evening to the reading of the Word, which will inspire within you a greater affection, a greater worship that is true worship. Because God is not only looking for us to worship Him in the Holy Ghost. He's looking for us to worship Him in truth. And His word alone is truth. And it does not matter what situation you find against you. It doesn't matter what thing, circumstance, or thing tries to bring you into bondage. The word of God is truth. And if you take hold of the word of God, the truth will set you free so that that yoke is broken off of you. The minute you agree with God, the minute you agree with Him. And that's what praise is all about. It's thanking God for everything He said to us in His word. And believing everything He said to us in His word, because His word, when we agree, when our will agrees with His word, the creative power of His word becomes a living reality. The same authority that created the galaxies by the hundreds of thousands, by the hundreds of millions, by maybe the hundreds of an innumerable expression the hundreds of eternities, hundreds of eternities. Because all of his creation expresses who he is. He's eternal. So when somebody says, well, we believe that there's 275,000 galaxies, they're off by a few eternities. They're off by so many zeros that there's no room to write them. Because it goes on and on. And within that, there's thousands and tens of thousands of solar systems. And that same word has brought forth the span of the heavens, of the eons. He created, you know, that's what the scripture says. He created the eons. Did you know that? I know the translation says in Hebrews, most translations, including King James, says he created the worlds. By whom he created all, by whom also he created the worlds. No, by whom also he created the eons. And there's no text that has a different word there. It's all eons. That word is in full 100% agreement with all extant manuscripts, when there are, in other words, all existing Greek documents or ancient documents that have the word of God in it. He created the eons. Whew. He's also spoke his word and created in you and me. He's called forth this glory. He's called forth this greatness. He's called forth the sonship. He's called forth this beauty. He's called forth the praise. He's called forth the prophecy. He's called forth the working of his mighty power, a supernatural divine energy. He's called it forth. People look to themselves, I'm tired tonight, or I'm tired today, or I'm weak, or I feel this, or I feel that. Forget about that. God wants to do something so supernatural inside of you that you no longer are living after the natural influences of a human physical body or material world. There's a greater power at work on the inside of us than anything on the outside of us. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And there's a treasure in these earthen vessels. If that same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you, he'll make alive your mortal body. There's a work on the inside of us far greater than the influences outside of us. We just have to start agreeing with God. Amen. on a different basis.
Yeah.
We agree with God on the basis of what he said in his word, and it's a pure stream. It's a pure river. It's not contaminated. It's not a stream that flows through the swamp before it gets to you. Are you listening to me? You can talk about how wonderful that spring is, but if you're drinking it on the other side of the swamp, and it doesn't matter. Come on, people. Go to the fountainhead, Christ Jesus. Amen. To the rock. Go to the rock. That's where the water's flowing. I'm about to say to you, hey, you know what? It can be a battle. It can be a battle. The enemy will constantly remind you of who you are, because he's the accuser of the brethren. He's not the accuser of the world. He's already got them. He's saying, you guys are doing great. Us, he's accusing us. Okay. The rest of the world, he's like encouraging them. He's the enemy of our soul. And we have to find our strong defense in the Word of God. The Word of God describes the whole of the armor of God. The whole of everything that Father has given to us, both defensively, offensively. Satan can do his worst, and I never even knew he did anything. Are you with me?
Yes.
Satan can do his worst, and I never know that he even was breathing. Never know that anything happened. Why? Raptured in the glory. Caught up in the realms of heaven. Standing there face to face. Beholding Almighty God in the holies of holies, where the seraphim veil their face and you can barely stand. The wind of heaven's about to knock you down. It's a tsunami. Satan be screaming all he wants. If you're standing in that place, you can't hear nothing that he's saying or feel nothing that he's doing. Did you know that in reality, from a quantum physics point of view, darkness does not even exist? Doesn't exist. It cannot be measured. Only the quantum of light can be measured. Think about it, Tifa. Think about it for just a minute. Think about the reality of what it means to hook up with that light which no man has seen, nor anyone can approach unto, that unchanging, immutable one, who's now brought you and I into such a... You can never intellectually understand these things. It is a relationship that you must give yourself to. It's a love that goes beyond knowledge. You're never going to be able to sit and diagram yourself into some kind of revelation. You do Psalms 149 into it. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He'll beautify the meek with salvation. Ugly people become attractive in the anointing. Old people look young in the anointing. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Come on, listen to those power-packed words. You can't be joyful outside the glory, dear people. You just got to try to put on a happy face. We're talking about something that's real. We're talking about a motive so real. Ooh, a supernatural event happening on the inside of you that you couldn't frown if you tried. You couldn't be unhappy if you thought real hard about some terrible thing. If you were an actor, it would be completely, you'd be done if your skit had to, you know, have the performance of sorrow and sadness. You can't find it. There's no place for it. In that place, there's no remembrance of sin. You don't even kind of bring to mind that you did any, that there was any wrongdoing. You got to start getting distance from the glory to start being reminded about a lot of this stuff. Immediately, what that ought to do is cause you to run in terror to the presence of the Lord. I drifted far enough to start listening to that stinking liar in the realm of that which doesn't even exist. Place of death. A place cut off from life, cut off from truth, cut off from reality. God's working his miracles here tonight. God's working his miracles here tonight. I'm in expectation of encountering him in a way that goes beyond anything that I've ever experienced. I'm going to press into this. I'm going to give myself to such an expectation. And I pray that you will, that you won't just live in whatever it is that you live in. Where the most exciting thing that you can think of to do is like go on a cruise. Or watch the latest movie. I mean, it's like, you know, this is like, you know, Dante only come up with 7 rings of hell. There's additions to it now. That is just really a lifeless, pathetic state. When Father has brought us into this grand adventure, the excitement, I'm going to tell you right now. If the Lord didn't have me busy right here, I'd take off of Stetson and Jake and the rest of them and go to the Congo. Wow, it's like, it's a dream. It's like, it's just as much of an unreached people group as anybody else ever dreamed of, North Korea or, you know, Kashmir or Nepal. And then to have these open doors that God himself is opening up right now across the nations of the earth. Don't you sit around and get bored. Don't you sit around wondering what you can do. Get in. It's a grand adventure, people. Throw aside whatever it is that's hindering you. Grab a hold of the truth and watch God take care of you. He'll provide great for you. You guys been lacking anything? No, you're not going to lack anything. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. When's the last time you did that? We believe in practicing all of the Word of God. We do. You know, most of the time, especially on Sunday nights, you have no problem rising at midnight and praising Him. See, that's about the time you're getting to bed. And it's never planned. It's not like, you know, we're going, okay, well, you know, we're not at midnight yet, so we're going to drudge through this thing. It's just, you know. Antiboy and the church, 1.8 miles by 1.8 miles, they start their church service at 6 in the afternoon, in the evening, and it goes to 6 in the morning. It's 6 to 6. That is so cool. And you don't see anybody going, the power of God's moving into place. Hallelujah. Somebody said, what are they, don't they sleep? They got 6 more nights to sleep. What are you talking about? What's all that sleep been doing for you anyways? There is a supernatural realm with God. Come on now. Lord, touch that baby right now. In every language, that means, Pastor, you need to pray for me. In every language. Japanese, Chinese, Mandarin, Cantonese, every language. Nepali, Hindi, Arabic, doesn't matter. I need a pastor to pray for me right now. And that Jesus, we thank you for touching that baby. Make that baby whole right now in Jesus' name. It's a new baby that Karen's just adopted. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
There's so many ways to save children. So many ways to save souls, reach people. One at a time, they're very valuable. Everyone. God's got a great life for us to live. All we got to do is be willing to enjoy it. Let the high praises of God be in your mouth. Let a sharp two-edged sword be in your hand to execute vengeance upon the heathen. Huh? And I put that on several categories. First and foremost, the demonic realm. And then after that, anybody's trying to stand in my way and keep me from preaching the gospel, I'm taking you out. You're not going to be able to stop me spiritually. You know, we're not pulling out a sword. I'm not going to be stopped. Hallelujah. You're not going to be stopped either in Jesus' name. He says, and punishment upon the people to bind their kings with chains, their nobles with fetters of iron. Try to get out of that, will you? To execute upon them judgment written. This honor has all the saints. Praise you, the Lord. Let me just, before I get to my text, it's still just introductory stuff here. I'm going to try to be a little quicker with my introduction. That's one of my big problems. That's why the church isn't bigger. Not. I would have to change the message, redo the music, reorganize. I'm not going to get into it. And I would do any of the above, so just forget about it. Let the people, verse 5, let the people praise him. Let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. Then guess what's going to happen? Then the earth will yield the increase. And we talk about your earth. Then the earth will yield the increase, and God, even our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us, and all the ends of the earth shall fear him because of what's going on in our life. They'll be scared to death over the blessing of God upon us. And his manifest presence, the fruit-bearing realms of his character, of his nature, of his gifts, and of his power. This is what Father says. He wrote the Psalms, but he didn't know that. He's the same one who wrote the New Testament, did the Old Testament. The same one talking about praise and thanksgiving that we're getting ready to discuss here in just a minute is the one who authored this. Praise and acknowledging who God is. And moving with him in the things that he's provided for us is going to be a disagreement. It's the basis of faith. The basis of faith is to say amen. That's the basis of faith. In the Hebrew language, is amen. Just simply to agree with God. That agreement with God, that trust that he's going to do what he said he's going to do. Amen. Father breathed on that in a supernatural way, and now we got faith. And faith is, by definition, that which moves mountains and that which changes the course of nature. Says sycamine tree, be plucked up by the roots and planted in the sea. That walks on the water at his word. Speak the word only. I'm going to move with the word only. God's talking to you. He's talking to us. Look real quickly as I'm headed as fast as I can to Acts chapter 4. Just stop by and visit Daniel for a moment. Let's listen to what Daniel has to say in his relationship with the Lord. And the way he stepped into a place. You know, Daniel had a divine favor in God that placed him above the five rulers under the king of the greatest empire on earth at the time. And he was chief over all of them. That's what you read about in Daniel chapter 6. What is that called? Divine favor. Wonder how he got that. All we need to do is look at his life and see what he did with his life. And then we will discover the secret of his divine favor. There is not one person who was ever used by God and blessed with God, by God, that he did not also reveal to us, if it is a secret, the secret that brought them into such favor, that brought them into such usefulness in the kingdom. And all we got to do is be careful to listen, read it, and then imitate it. There's nothing that God has done for anybody ever that he won't do for you. They were also born of a mother with an earthly body, with the same potentials and the same issues and the same frailties. Elijah, who is a man subject to like passions as we are, said, "It's not going to rain," and it didn't rain. Such a walk with God, such a place where he pleased God that God just took him up in glory. All you have to do is look into their life. Say, I want this so much. Father looks at us. He sees us. Father, I want this so much, whatever it takes. He sees us seeking him, diligently seeking him or not. He sees us hungering and thirsting or not. You know, you have to ask yourself, on a scale of 1 to 10, how hungry am I? On a scale of 1 to 10, how thirsty am I? And make it a 10. And then, no matter what's been up to this point, make it a 10, and then begin to understand, look at those people who had that, because Father is not going to leave you thirsty when you have that thirst for him, nor is he going to disappoint you and leave you hungry when you've got that kind of hunger. He's going to come and fill you. He's going to come and satisfy you. He's going to come and meet you with every good thing. You lay hold on this abiding place.
Amen.
Lay hold on these things in Jesus' name. And now, I just got to read verse 3. Then this Daniel was preferred above all the presidents and all the princes, not by God, by the ruling tyrant. Think about it. Hillary Clinton could not compare to the tyranny of those rulers and kings. Nero was far worse than her. I mean, come on, people. I hate to bring that. I hate to bring it into the context of your life right now. But listen to me. Come on, folks. Oh, if she becomes it, we're not going to be able. Give me a break. Just listen to Paul. He was there, subjugated, as it were, to some degree, to the rulership of Nero. He said, pray for him. Romans 13. Oh, that we would return to God. Oh, that we would agree with God, that he's greater in power. He's higher than the highest. Greater than the greatest, wiser than the wisest, older than the oldest, mightier than the mightiest. Suddenly all these things that get in our way and stop us and prevent us become irrelevant. Suddenly Satan is not able to do as many tricks against us. Huh? And it matters not what he does. The bottom line of it is, if somehow somebody ends up dying preaching the gospel, you get an extra crown.
Amen.
You get an extra crown. You get the martyr's crown. You know, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I was telling somebody that was talking to me the other day who'd been in prison. I said, I probably end up spending a number of years in prison too. He's looking at me for preaching the gospel. I've set my heart on making sure that I'm going to bind kings and I'm going to bind princes and noblemen. And there's no dictator that's going to say, you can't bring the gospel into my nation. No, I'm going to step into these high praises. I'm going to step into this realm of God's bigger than you all. Huh? No, I've been in sketchy situations. I've been in situations where they're rocking the taxi cab. The taxi cab driver, grown man's now crying like a baby. They're trying to tip the thing over. They got guns out, banging them on the windows, trying to break the windows to get at me. To take me out in the middle of the desert, outside of Alexandria, Egypt, and have such an authority and such a peace of God. Come on, man. And it begins right here in this context where we're threatened every day by all the things that go on in the society in Southern California. Because if we're stopped here, we're going to be stopped everywhere. Look, I mean, come on, people. There is a place where you just, and I'm headed there. Some of you know where I'm going, because I already gave you a hint. Acts chapter 4, you can feel it building. You can feel it building. I'll show you some things. We're going to talk about some things, I'm pressing into some things, about how to take hold of the explosive power of God, where nothing can stop you, nothing can prevent you. No matter what your circumstance is, if it's a prison at night, you're chained to the wall, you've been stripped bare, butt naked, and whipped in public. Because that's what they did. It wasn't like, you know, we're going to give you a little spanking out here in front of everybody. Everybody turn your head for a few moments. They stripped Paul and Silas naked. And they went to laying the whip to their backside. Public humiliation. Chain them to a prison wall without a TV. Or a window to look outside. We're talking about moldy, damp, rat-infested, disease-infested prisons. They were made to torture men. Damp, moldy. They say, I can't remember exactly where it is. It might actually even be in Zambia. That if you get thrown, a lot of different places in Africa, but there's certain places that are even scaled up higher, that if you get thrown in prison in some of these nations, you're not going to last 2 years because it's just so filthy. It's just so disease ridden. That's the kind of condition they were in. Why are they praising God and worshiping Him? They're not in prison spiritually. Nobody can imprison them. I want you to grab a hold of this. I want you to grab a hold tonight of taking His word and standing in His word and confessing His word and proclaiming His word and prophesying His word and prophesying over yourself those things which He said. In the midst of that, you're going to get so excited that praise and thanksgiving is going to come busting out of you. And I don't care what your condition is. I don't care how bad it is for you. You're going to have yourself a supernatural breakout. Yes. You have a supernatural breakout. God, the Holy Ghost is talking to you. You're going to have a supernatural bust out. Heaven's going to come. In response to you is going to interrupt every earthly thing. Out of over an excitement of somebody who gets what God has done for us through His only begotten Son, Jesus. Thank you, Father, for touching baby right now in Jesus' name. Lo rasete. Lo rasiprambante. Lo rasipramashlek doctoramashiprate. Eleman likapane estipakaloste. Papa's going to have to preach with you here. I'm going to let you get a little bit bigger. Bron John Day, Ezekiel James, you prophet of the Most High God, separated by the Spirit of the Lord, even from the womb, conceived in the will and mind of God, fashioned for divine purposes. What am I doing? I'm speaking by inspiration
the word of God, declaring it over a soul, and he's being fashioned by it, by the word of God, because I agree with what God has said. I'm allowing that word of God to ultimately then do and accomplish that which it was sent forth to accomplish.
Amen.
She's not going to violate your will, my will. His word is powerful, it's living, it's spirit, it's life. Oh, to grab a hold of it, to quit prognosticating vain imaginations, to quit speaking out of the realms of fear and past experience, to recognize, wow, God has awaiting for me such a place of divine appointment and opportunity of greatness, of exploits, not to somehow sell out to some form of compromise, to some form of an agreement that it's going to be just like it's always been. No, that's not hunger. That's not truth. That's not letting God be God. Daniel, they can't find anything against Daniel. They're jealous. They're tired of this Jewish guy being greater than them. He's over all the presidents and the princes. Because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set him over all the whole realm. That's favor. I said that's favor on the highest level that is available to anyone, for God is no respecter of persons. Whatever he's done for one person, you can grab a hold of it and say, I'll have that too. It's true. When God begins to speak, it may be a word of knowledge for one person, but if everybody grabs it, they all get it.
Amen.
It's just the way the word of God is.
Amen.
To the general assembly of the firstborn. Hallelujah. God just looking for somebody to agree with what the word has spoken. How did you get this favor? Daniel, a conquered people, a despised people, a people that was ridiculed and persecuted by divine design because of their sin and iniquity. God had given them over to be persecuted and to be the outcast and to be those who were despised by the nations. That's why I say by divine design. But yet he steps into the favor of God. How? Here's how. Verse 10. Listen to him. They've written a command, you can't worship. Some people would rather be thrown to the lions rather than worship. Daniel, would rather worship. Did it matter? Some people are just like, you know, you cannot bring them to a place for any price or any cost to worship. It seems like there's always something getting in the way. There was nothing going to prevent Daniel from worshiping and praising, even if it meant a lion's den, his head taken off. It did not matter what threats there were. There is a character there that we got to grab a hold of. There is a knowledge there that we got to lay hold of. There is a relationship there. It's something that's way beyond religion. It's like, there ain't nothing you can do to me to shut me up. This threatens not only his life, his position, but his life, everything that he has, everything that he's enjoyed. Reality of it is God gave it to him anyways, so it's not like he's trying to hold on to something. Think about the character, the resolve that is there. Understand, if you want to find favor, then you're going to have to participate with us. You're going to have to say, Father, I want to have that same kind of consecration. I want to have that same kind of knowledge of who you are. Daniel's living in the old covenant. He's living in a time of the ministry of condemnation. And he's got this acceptance in the beloved. He's living in the dispensation of draw not nigh. You can't come near me, you sinner. And he's got this kind of acceptance in the beloved, as it were. This kind of confidence in God, this kind of certainty in God. Come on, people. There's not any of us now in the new covenant that have been brought into the ministry of righteousness, that have been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, that have any right or excuses. This is swinging the pendulum when you look at Daniel. We got to grab a hold of it. If we will, you're going to get the product.
Verse 10. Now Daniel knew that it had been written and signed that anybody that worshiped any deity or any god beside the king or made any petition outside a petition to the king should be put to death. He knew it was signed. He knew it was written. Here's what he did. He went into his house. He went into the closet, dark room. It was well insulated where no one could hear him. And he began to cry out to God in a secret lockdown place. No, he threw open the window. Look at the character. Look at the authority to bind kings. Look at the authority to loose a nation. Look at the authority to represent God. As the high praises of God was in his mouth. Some people were taken out by a little cold, a little sniffle. Some people were taken out by a little pain in their backside. Some people were taken out by the smallest little threats of their convenience. Come on, people. Come on now. Where is the mighty host of the mighty God? They're going to stand up and say with all boldness, this is what God has declared. Somebody said, so-and-so said, or the doctor said, or the lawyer said, or the attorney said, or the judge said. Was it written in the Bible? Then it's not true. What is written in the Bible is true. Amen. So you bring all your evidences that you want. You bring all your proofs. You bring all your threats. I don't believe any of them. Let's hear a man of God say his wife was hemorrhaging. First baby, his wife was hemorrhaging. And they said to him, we've got to do this thing or that thing. And it was going to threaten the life of the baby and everything. Because if we don't do something quickly, your wife is going to die from hemorrhaging. He said, it's not written in the Bible. Everybody looks at him like he's a crazy man. But his stand brought healing to his wife. Think about it, people. What if the resolve is that it doesn't matter what the results are? What if the resolve is that it doesn't matter what the results are, whether we live or whether we die? Hear this. We will not compromise. We will not bow before your threats. Think about it. Think about it. You're not only seeing this in chapter 2 with Daniel's companions. Somebody said, where was Daniel then? He was on vacation or somewhere else. Because I guarantee you he'd have been in the fiery furnace with his companions. Because we get to see in chapter 6 the same exact resolve, the same exact character, the same exact devotion that does not come out of religion, doesn't come out of discipline. It comes out of relationship. It is a passion. You are beholding passion here. You are beholding passion. Somebody said, oh, if it doesn't accommodate my convictions, I don't agree with it. Well, if your convictions don't match the word, they're deceptions. I'm not talking about convictions. I'm talking about a consecration to the word of God. I'm talking about just go ahead and knock on another door. And let them accuse you, whatever. Now we got Facebook, get even a bigger crowd. What, your last crowd on Facebook was what, 300-400 people? Something like that. You tell me, what was it? Try not to think too hard.
Oh, it's in a contest. It's over 200.
Like over 200 people. So praise God, just Facebook post. Just 200 people there. Well, what happens when you begin to say, wait a minute, you know, I'm not satisfied with 200 people. What if you begin to press in and say, Father, I know what results you want to have in the context of the, as 1.4 million people that are here. Hallelujah. Just moving in faith, moving in a passion, and moving in a confidence that God, that is only found in this intimacy, in this relationship with him. Because we try to skip over the relationship and the intimacy and go do something and it's not going to work out. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into the house, he threw open the windows towards Jerusalem. He kneeled upon his knees, and everybody already knew what he was going to do. And they knew where he was going to do it at. because he always did it in the palace in a public place because he had, was above everybody. He had the most opulent room in the palace outside the king. He had the best view. He had the place where everybody could give him the most honor. Throws open the windows and he begins to bellow out. Hallelujah. And here's what he begins to bellow out. He begins to bellow out his prayers and the giving of thanks to God as he did always. 3 times a day. We got some relationship going on here. Not discipline, not religion, passion. Because the discipline in a religion would have fainted and fallen off the race long before this. Are you with me? With that level of threats, with that amount of loss in every dimension of your life. Now I want you to go with me to Acts chapter 4. I want you to understand there's something that you and I can get a hold of if we'll understand the provision that God has given to us and cooperate with it. Faith is a product of relationship. It's not something that we're waiting on God to give us, and then when we have more from him, then we can do more. Faith is a result of interacting with him. And the only right way to interact with God is by praise and by thanksgiving. And so let's look here. Acts chapter 4, Peter and John get in trouble. Why? Miracles. Miracles will not only change people's life, will not only amaze you, amaze everybody around you, change nations, change the world. But it will get you in trouble. And it got Peter and James in trouble, Peter and John in trouble. And so they severely threatened after, you know, the Inquisition took place. They examined the person who's made whole. They've examined them. And we can see the resolve. There's no backing down here. There's no compromise. I'm going to skip over that. So they threaten them. They let them go. And then it brings us to, let's just pick it up at verse 21. So when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding nothing that they might punish them for, because of the people, for all men glorified God for that which was done. For the man was about 40 years of age, whom the miracle of healing was showed or took place. And being let go, they went to their own company and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said unto them, because they were threatened, said, don't you ever talk or preach again in this name. And when they heard that, here's the response. Look at this response. They lifted up their voice. They didn't begin to look to other things. They didn't begin to look to the means by which they had to sue them, or by which they had, you know, their constitutional rights, and who are going to support them in the Senate and the Congress, and who's going to be there, whatever. Immediately, their resolve is to lift up their voice and begin to cry out to God. Listen, if we're going to ever have a breakthrough on any level, in any dimension of our life, no matter what we're confronting, we can't look to how we're going to work our way out of this situation. How that somehow by more effort of human ability, we're going to change the outcome. There has to be a response in our heart and in our life. We begin to lift up our voice. We begin to cry out to God and acknowledge that he hears our prayers, because there's going to be a supernatural result. Listen, I'm telling you, there's going to be some specific things that are described in the nature of these folks that are gathered here in Acts chapter 4 that you and I are going to have to agree with and participate with if we're going to ever have their results. We're going to have their response if we're going to have their results. You know, people, anytime you're looking for the arm of flesh to do something, you're not relying on Jesus. Anytime you're, it's the same as asking for quail rather than being satisfied with the manna. Well, better than that, asking for quail instead of being blessed with the manna. the supernatural miracle of the hand of God's divine provision every day for you? Much to say on that. Here's what they say. Look, listen to this prayer. When they heard this, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord. There is a beautiful thing of maturity in a congregation of people where everybody allows the Spirit of God to develop them and take them to the same place of confidence and boldness in God, so that whatever's taking place, the same kind of result is just a spontaneous reaction within the house. And everybody immediately goes to God. And they lift up their voice and they say to him, they acknowledge who he is. You, the maker of heaven and earth. They place God verbally in their own thinking, in their own heart, in their own disposition, as being the greatest power, the absolute authority, higher than everything else. It's not just accolades to throw at God to remind him who he is. It is a worship to who he is. It is a declaration of who he is by the Spirit. It is a place that takes us to a whole nother level of faith for a whole nother disposition of exploits. God, at the threats, immediately our heart turns. You're the Most High. You're the Sovereign. You're the Almighty. Nobody makes a move unless you ordain it, unless you fashion it, unless you give the say-so in it. Lord, you're the maker of heaven and earth. The sea and all that is in it. Listen to him. Who by the mouth of your servant David said, the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing. They're setting up the circumstance of the war. They're putting themselves in a place where they're in conflict with all that is against God. And Father is the one who's leading the charge here. And all they're doing is hooking up their response and their disposition in alignment with what he's doing. They're describing the state and the situation that they are confronting. And they are now beginning to identify themselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and with the Father and say, Lord, basically, look at how they're treating us. They're treating us right now just like they treat you, just like they treat your only begotten Son, who Pontius Pilate, Herod, and the Gentiles, goes through the list, and your own people took and with wicked hands crucified. They're laying it out there. Lord, we're in the same fighting condition right now. They're telling us what we can and cannot do. The kings of the earth stood up, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord, against you, Lord, and against your Christ, his Christ. They're finding themselves in the context of the Word of God and in the position of the servants of God, God who is the Most High, who has created everything by his own power and by his own might. And they're the ones doing his service, and they're the ones who are doing his bidding. Can you hear it?
Yes.
For of a truth, against your holy child Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod, Pontius Pilate, the Gentiles, the people of Israel gathered themselves together, for to do whatever your hand and your counsel determine before to be done. So they're recognizing there is nobody that can do anything beyond the boundaries of that which you've ordained and what you have set. You hear it? Total agreement with God. Finding themselves in full alliance with him, doing what it is he's doing right now, both in heaven and in the earth. What are you doing? You're agreeing with God's word. You're laying hold on the power and the commission that he's given. And in this view, and in this place, having declared the scripture, having declared the word of God, having found their place, not only just hearing the word of God, because many people have come to church today throughout the nation of the United States of America to hear the word of God. But very few people are willing to do it and move with it. They're doing it and moving with it, and they're making it known by their confession. Because we think, wait a minute, how is it that they prayed as a seemingly such a short prayer, and the place wherein they prayed was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And once again, they've already been filled, but they were continually being filled. But this was a unique field. This wasn't a rushing mighty wind and clothed in tongues of fire. This was a shaking. This was an earthquake produced by the people of God praying. They were the epicenter. It wasn't the shifting of tectonic plates. This was the prayers of God's saints. This was the high praises of God and a sharp two-edged sword in their hand. This was the high praises of God's people declaring the word of God, that which Father has said, and put themselves in the same position and the same posture with Father's divine will and purpose. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings. Here's how nations are conquered. This is how a nation is conquered. This is how cities are taken. There's a divine realm of grace that you and I step into as we relentlessly pursue all that God has made available for us. You know, I used to watch, I've been many times at the office of Carlos Anacondia. You walk into his office, his desk is over here. There's a couple of other little pieces of furniture over here. But right here on this wall is a map of the world. And there's also a map of South America. Have you ever been in his office? Okay. A man who was nothing more than a businessman, Roman Catholic, raised Roman Catholic, gave himself to making wealth, become relatively wealthy for a person from Argentina. God takes this man and uses him to change South America, Central America. One of the greatest, most effective evangelists of the 20th century. And what he did was he just began to obey God's word on a simple level. He went out and began to feed the poor. He went out, because he read just basic scriptures in the Bible, he went out and started going to the hospitals and praying for anybody they let him pray for. He's doing real basic things. He wasn't interested in a crowd, was interested in the people that he could get to. But what happened? Suddenly a crowd came. Why? Because somebody put themselves in the context of what God was doing. They put themselves in the very context of the battle that Father is engaged in. The context of living out his will, doing the scripture. He got to a place where he'd just come, he'd lay his hands on a particular, people started getting invited all over the place, because crowds, when crowds get over 100,000 people, everybody wants to know what's the secret. And I'm talking to you about the secret tonight. The high praises of God, sharp two-edged sword in your hand. The high praises and the word of God, everything, you live it by the word, speaking the word of God. You don't let the word of God depart out of your mouth. It's nigh thee, even your heart and your mouth. You stay right with the word of God. That's your prophecy. That's your declaration. That's your praise. That's the way you think. Anything else tries to invade your thoughts, you kill it. Amen. You lay his hands on the map and he begins to ra-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. You know, I heard it tell about where he'd be just in someone's living room or out to dinner or out to eat, and someone walk in and he would recognize they weren't saved. He'd immediately go into a place where it was the bathroom, but that was the only place to get alone. He'd go in there and begin to a passion, a divine grace that he entered into because he was willing to participate with God. And he would pray in that bathroom till the yoke was broken. He would come out and person to be set free from the demon spirit, from the mind-blinding spirit. They'd give their life to the Lord. Because he wasn't living after the realms of the intellect. He was living after the realms of the spirit. He wasn't living after the realms of religion and ideology. He wasn't depending upon himself, his own skill sets, his own ability, his own half to be a witness. He began to take a hold of a divine grace, a divine power, a divine ability. God's calling us to quit living our own life, serving ourselves, doing our business, and trying to write God into it. He wants you and I to start doing his business, living his life, doing those things which he's passionate about. Amen. This is the point, people. This is the break point. This is a break point for everybody in every nation everywhere as to whether or not they're going to move into the supernatural favor, into the supernatural display of the power of God, and the witness of the glory of God that is given to each and every one of us that resides on the inside of us, the excellency of His power that we have right now in these earthen vessels, this treasure of God, this glory of God that is super abundantly able to do more than we can think or ask. Many times we have situations, circumstances, we become overwhelmed by them and we're like, oh God, I'm just a miserable wretch. And nothing works out for me. Loser, loser, loser. We don't realize we're abdicating. You can't write God into that. You ain't going to find His will in that. You're not going to say, Father, You the maker of heaven and the earth and the seas and all that is in them. And You see how that all the world and the nations and the kings and the rulers thereof are set against You as they are set against us right now. And we're not going to budge any more than You budge. Because that's what they're saying. Right. We're not doing anything different than what Jesus did. And they're going to come and kill us and let it be done. Because nobody can budge beyond that which You have determined according to the counsel of Your own will. Hear it. Suddenly in this context, God makes of the most pathetic cowards the mightiest and fearless of men, bravest of men and women. It can stare death in the face and just laugh and say, you have no power here. You have no right here. You do not know what you're messing with. When I walked into this room, the power Almighty God walked in here. Be careful what you do. True. Father gives us that boldness. I wasn't on vacation when I said that, by the way. Sightseeing. I don't find myself somehow different or other from God. By myself, one with Him. What He's doing, I'm doing. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Will you do it?
Yes.
Will you stop listening to the threats?
Yes.
Will you stop being moved by the threats?
Yes.
And the lies?
Yes.
And the intimidation? And the Lord's not going to allow you to be tested above what you're able. And He sees you being overcome because your favorite television program got canceled for the night. I mean, you know, that's just where you're at. You know what I'm saying? Or you're overcome because of some other little silly, stupid thing that I can't think of right now, but it's on the same level, but you've made it really huge and important. And then I'm going to say something else too. When Father, when you've been willing to let God prepare you in every good work and He starts doing greater signs and wonders and exploits in your life and you're walking around suddenly with a sad face and a disgruntled countenance and a bickering, you know, complaining, murmuring attitude, you bring greater disgrace to God's kingdom and to the name of Jesus than you ever was able to bring glory. You're on another level of responsibility to shine with His joy, to shine with His presence, to shine with His praises, to shine with His goodness, to walk in His light, to present His kingdom. Because all of a sudden people start seeing the glory, signs and wonders, the power and the demonstration of God in your life, and then they see the compromises and the sin, then they must conclude that the compromises and the sin is okay with God. And so you're a wrong testimony altogether. And Father empowered you to do it? I don't think so. I don't believe that's how it works. In fact, I can go beyond that and say, that isn't how it is. These things are sacred to Father. Satan could do lying signs and wonders to try to create those kinds of conclusions. But what Father's wanting to do through you and I looks like what He did through Daniel. Looks like what He did through Jesus. Looks like what He did through Paul, Peter, and James. Peter and James and John, Paul, man, those guys were getting themselves in troubles right, left, and center. I mean, James must have been the rat. You know, James and John were the sons of thunder. Those aren't the quiet, shy guys. You don't look at the quiet, shy guys and go, sons of thunder. There's a possibility that it was a prophecy, but nonetheless, they came into it, okay? If it wasn't what they were then and their disposition then, they stepped right into the sons of thunders. That's not a quiet person. And if you have never read the epistles of John, you recognize you're listening to some thunder. Yeah. Are you with me?
Yes.
James was more radical than them all. That's why they killed him first. They tried to kill his brother, but he wouldn't kill. Hallelujah. So who was better off, James or John? Both lived out the will of Father according to the counsel of his will. Both of them stepped over into the glories of the kingdom. I mean, both of them have run their race, their work is done, and they're looking at you and me and say, come on, man. Come on. Come on. I can hear heaven sometimes. Come on. What's up? What are you doing now? Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Here you have the power of the God who created the heaven, the earth, and the seas, and everything that is within them. You think somehow you're on your own? No, you need to look to God. You need to acknowledge Him. You need to turn to Him and say, you're the one who's going to supply this. You're the one who's going to resource us. You're the one who's going to do the works that no one else could do. You're the one who's going to stop these threats, these lies, this work of the enemy. They say, after they remind Father by the word of God of how all the world and all of its system is opposed to Him and to His only begotten Son, they say, and now they're opposed to us too, because we're doing your work. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings. They're doing exactly what they're doing to you, to us. What a great place to find yourself. To find yourself in the same disposition of God Almighty. The same condition that He Himself is in. The same kind of response. The same kind of insults that He Himself is incurring. Come on, people. Can you hear? Don't run and hide in shame. Don't get discouraged. Don't be disappointed. Say, looky here, Father. They are threatening me with the same threats that they are laying on you. The same reproaches that they are laying on you. They reproach me with them too. I pray you get yourself into that right now. I pray you'll discover that the greatness of God will be found in your life by you simply doing His will and going and seeking and saving that which is lost, going everywhere and preaching the gospel for any cost, because you so embrace the cross, you love every part of His life. Hear me. Lord, behold their threatenings and grant unto your servants that with all boldness they may speak the word, and listen to the very foundation, the very core, the very precedence of everything that God wants us to be believing for and doing. It is the sum total, as it were, the ministry of the gospel. By stretching forth your hand to heal and to do signs and wonders by the name of your holy child Jesus. If we have any other purpose, if we have any other gospel, if we have any other thing that we want Father to get behind and be a part of and champion, it won't work. This is what He's doing. This is what Jesus did. For no other, there would have been no other just cause. There would have been no other prayer that Father would have answered. People want to say this prayer without even having experienced the threats of being put in jail or being put to death. They want to pray this prayer and wonder, well, we were just believing God would come shake the place and
fill us with the Holy Ghost so we can jump around and shout and say hallelujah. He's not gonna, he loves us. It's cute. It's sweet and everything. But you haven't, you just been, you know, the Lord's gonna, there's gonna be no response. There's no agreement. There's no doing what he said to do. There's no reason for him to move into that, the midst of that. If at some point your consecration to him, your love, your dedication to him is that you're willing to give your life, then there is a proof and an evidence that you're not going to take his glory and profane his name with it. Can you hear that? There's a response in our conduct and our behavior that reveals our heart, that reveals our relationship. And I want you to understand that fundamental to the development of this relationship, this knowledge of the Lord, this commitment, this consecration, is this place where you just begin by interacting with them on another level of having these Holy Ghost praise and worship services, whether you in the church place or not, where it's going on, where there is this encounter that you having in a public situation with the Almighty God, where everybody about you knows, everybody in Babylon, what a place, knew. Everybody in the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians knew what Daniel was doing at 9 o'clock in the morning. It didn't matter how taxing the business was. They knew what he was doing at 9 o'clock in the morning and at noon and at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. He'd be found praising God on his knees. Suddenly the place was shaken. You know the rest of the story. The rest of the events. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost and spake the word with boldness. If you go on the passage, you look at the commitment that was in the house too. Why they were all in this place of moving with God as one man. Because everybody took the things that they possessed and they sold them and they laid them at the feet of the apostles, and distribution was made to everyone who had need, so that there was no lack among them. God's economy. Huh? Sounds like something that conservative Christians would be strongly against right now. A couple of laughs. Sounds like something that conservative Christians would be strongly against right now. How are you listening to me?
Yes.
Yeah. You know, capitalism is not in the Bible. It has nothing to do with God's plan. I know that people would file out the meeting when I say stuff like that. Turning off the web right now. Jesus. Jesus. I'm going to show you two verses of scripture that I pray that you'll start doing so that you'll find favor with God and with men. I'll say it again. We'll give you two verses of scripture, two contexts of verses of scripture. You'll start doing so, you'll find favor with God and men. If you'll do it, you'll find favor with God and men. Daniel was highly favored of the Lord. I'm just reminded real quick, I just gotta take a glance over there at the conclusion of Job. Job's trying to, you know, figure out everything that was going on. You know how the Lord talked to him, so I'm not going to go through all of that. See if I can find Job. It's right here somewhere. Right there. It's the first verse, chapter 42. Here's Job. After the Lord tells him all that, the Lord lays it out. This is what I can do, and this is who I am. Now, who are you? 41, verse 1, you know, was Job's first response. So the Lord laid it on a little bit thicker, as it were. He just told him a little bit more about who he is and what he can do.
Huh? Father can brag on himself. If you don't believe that Father can seriously brag on himself, you need to read Job chapter 38 through 41. Because that's who he is. He's God. And it's fine because it's done with such purity and innocence and humility. Yeah. We can't even understand it. We'll misinterpret it. Job says, I know that you can do everything. You need to come to this conclusion. You can go ahead and get this conclusion without having to go through all the other stuff. Job had no idea that he was God's champion. He had to wait to learn that later. He had no idea what God was saying about him in the heavens. He had no idea. We didn't have an idea because we got to hear and see, as it were, from the book of Job, all that was going on, the dynamics of all that was going on in heaven and earth. He had no idea what God was saying. Well, I got a champion. I got one perfect man. And Job was like trying to figure out what's going on in my life. Why is this happening? He really stood strong in the word. No one's taking my uprightness from me. No one shall take my integrity of my righteousness, so long as I have breath in my being. For I know my Redeemer lives. Lord, I know that you can do everything. Yes. Well, in that knowledge, you never got another trouble in your life. You never have another problem in your life. You never have a situation too big for you. Huh? You never have to worry or concern yourself ever again. It's just like being in heaven. You have all the resources of Almighty God supplied to you, alongside of you, in you, available for whatever you have need of, whenever you want. Does that sound like the Bible? Yes. That's the relationship Father would like to develop. That's what he's doing in you. He's calling forth greatness in your life. You just need to start participating a little bit more. Huh?
Yes.
Come on, people. There's so many people that are supposed to be here tonight. They're not here tonight. You got to watch me from the home. Give me a break. How are we supposed to get through that? How are we supposed to get through the fact that you can't move, you can't get across town to come fill the house? Because it's like, listen, if everybody was staying at home, I mean, come on. We would be the assembly of the saints if everyone just took that posture. There's got to be a willingness to lay aside your convenience and what you're comfortable with and what suits you. And the fact that you really, really, really need your 8 hours of sleep and I preach too long or whatever other excuse. Father's calling you to greatness. This is such divine favor you can't even imagine. Such divine favor you won't even want to sleep. You won't work for pennies anymore. You won't work in the bondage of slave labor anymore. You step into the supply of God, the blessing of God. Come on, man.
Amen.
Jesus. Okay. Ephesians chapter 3. Now, if you don't do this, if you're not willing to grab a hold of these things, the relationship's never going to really be developed the way Father wants it to be developed. Thus, the faith is never going to function the way the Father's ordained it to function. The grace will not be able to be supplied because you're not participating. So just do these things. Start doing these things. Hear what Paul says to the church at Ephesus as he's now describing to them how to step into the manifestation of all the blessings that they've been blessed with in spiritual places. And he says in Ephesians chapter 3, beginning at verse 15, and he tells us this. Verse 14, for this cause, listen to how he's doing it. For this cause, this is what the Apostle Paul did. Who stands to us as a model of everything that Jesus purchased us at Calvary to be and baptized us in the Holy Ghost to have. Who preached everywhere throughout the world the full gospel with mighty signs and wonders and the demonstration of the power of God. He says, I bow my knee to the Father. I bow our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom every family is named in heaven and in earth. And in this place, now, same posture, same position that Daniel was in, he's going to make a request. He's going to ask Father that he would then cause those that were in the church that he was caring for, that they would receive a grant. They would receive an endowment from heaven. Right out of divine riches of God's grace. Boy, that's a big grant. That's a big endowment. That's a big fund for you. That they would be able to be strengthened out of the realms of this riches of his glory with the might of Almighty God in their inner being. That Christ would dwell in their hearts by faith so that they, being rooted and grounded and settled in heaven, listen to the lofty terms that he says this in, might be able to comprehend with all saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and be filled with all the fullness of God. My goodness, what a request, what a church. But there had to be a response, there had to be a participation, and we ultimately see what happened. We see a little wind, we see a wind of response and a wind of revival and a moving of God that changed everything about the dynamics, especially the religious dynamics, the state of the heart of the people of Ephesus, where the goddess Diana had been worshipped for so many hundreds of years, completely broken down. But ultimately, we then see what happened to them by the time Jesus is speaking to them in the book of Revelation as he addressed the church at Ephesus, and we understand the warnings that are going on. But if you and I just simply say, wait a minute, I see the posture of Daniel, I see the posture now here of the Apostle Paul, I see something that not only grants divine favor, that not only brings me into a participation with what Father is actively engaged in doing right now. Wisdom is knowing what God is doing and doing it with him. Do you hear me? To say, wait a minute, I got a posture. I know what I need to do. I'm bowing my knee before the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Come. Just come into a new dimension of fellowship. Come into a new dimension of fellowship. Come into a whole new response. Colossians chapter 3. I'm going to wrap this up and let God wrap you up. God, the Holy Ghost, wrap you up in his presence. I don't even know how to start on this and do it quickly. This word here in Colossians chapter 3 verse 16, it's a huge word. Let. Allow. Allow it. God's wanting to do something. Will you allow it?
Yes.
Allow the word of Christ to dwell in you richly.
Amen.
Word of Christ is going to dwell in you richly when you speak in your own words, thinking your own thoughts, doing your own thing. Describing the circumstance and the situation that you find yourself in and submitting yourself to it when it absolutely has nothing to do with life and reality and truth. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Here's the wellspring. Here's the high praises of God. Here's the thanksgiving that Father's purpose to be in our heart, to be in our mouth. In all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another. It's just the word of God with psalms, with hymns, with spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. How was that like on Sundays? On Sundays, on Wednesdays, maybe. No, Papa's talking about a state of our life and existence.
Amen.
Same thing is going on in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Rejoice evermore. Do you have to wait till you're about to die and suddenly you get it? Oh, we're supposed to rejoice always. That there's actually a place where you can always be happy and rejoicing in God. Some people have got, you know, on the idea of pray without ceasing and aren't certain how that's going to happen. Because this is the activity of the Holy Ghost. And if you can't live this, you can't do this. If you can't live this in your life, you can't do it in the meeting. You're going to be tired. And if we ask you, well, why don't you do this? Because you're tired. Why don't you do this? Because you're tired. Why don't you do this? Why don't you sing aloud on your bed? Because you're tired. Why don't you rise at midnight and praise Him? Because you're tired. Why don't you come with the evening and the morning sacrifice? Because you're tired. Or you're busy. It is hard to be allowing God to do much of anything when you're tired and busy. We speak healing to you right now in the name of Jesus. Especially those of you who couldn't drive to the meeting tonight. Well, I got to go back to Ephesians. I've got to just drive home this point real quickly, and it's not so quickly. But Ephesians chapter 5, same thing, just a little different, same exact thing. So here you are speaking the word of God, speaking the word of Christ, just giving yourself to letting the word of Christ dwell in you richly. You just always talk about the word. You're just rich in the word. Well, if you're not going to read the word, give yourself the word, you're not going to be rich in the word. You're going to be poor in the word. And you chose to be poor. The riches were right there before you, but you were tired. The riches were right there before you, but you were busy. Divine favor was yours to have, but you were tired. Or busy. This tired and busy stuff has got to come to an end. It's got to be nonsense. You got to laugh at tired and busy. You got to say, forget about tired and busy. They're not my priorities anymore. My priority is to begin to imitate those who laid hold on God. I want their results. I'm going to have their response.
Come
on. I'm going to have their fellowship. I'm going to have, Jesus gave us example after example. He said, do this, act like this, be like this, have this in your heart, bring this prayer, speak these things, and this is what I will do. But if you don't cooperate, he says, be filled with the Spirit. People get all these various different ideas. Redeem the time, for the days are evil. Vote for Trump. I couldn't resist. He'll fix everything. I don't want an America that man has made great.
Amen.
I don't know why people are impressed with that.
I want an America that God has made for. America began because of our ancestors who took a hold of God. Yeah. Your ancestors might not have taken a hold of God, but mine were here in 1624, and they took hold of God, and that was the product that we got, America. They fought the fight in the Massachusetts colonies. Hallelujah. They took hold of God. They took hold of that which God would do in this region of the world. That's all I want to. He says, here's how you do it. See problems? Is it dark and gross darkness over the people? Does it look like an impossible state? You rise and shine. Because the glory of God's risen upon you. Come on, people. Stop saying you're going to do it and not do it. Because this is something that you lay hold on that is so supernatural. It is a baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire that you begin to interact with, because you move beyond the condition that is purely human into an interaction with the supernatural and the divine. Hear me. Do it. Do it. You've got to lay hold on it. It may look like, some of you may not get it. It may look like it's impossible. You just don't see the dynamics of it. You need to start praising and giving thanks. Just start with real basics on a whole nother level and start pursuing this in God. And the spirit of wisdom and revelation will come to you. Your eyes will be open. I promise you, Father will grant unto you this according to his own power, according to his own might, to be strengthened by the Holy Ghost in your inner being.
Thank you, Lord.
So that you'll be able to get it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Jesus is here. Jesus is a key. Hallelujah. Jesus, he's here. He's like, Holy Spirit's just brooding over this. He's brooding over it. He broods over the word. God speaks the word, the Holy Ghost broods over it. Just like you read about it in Genesis, to bring it forth. You don't have to, if you start feeling all frustrated with yourself, all discouraged with yourself, all overwhelmed with yourself, forget about it. You lay hold on what he says. You say, Father, I'm going to lay hold on this.
Amen.
You say, well, I've been laying hold on it. I'm going to lay hold on it even more.
Yes, amen.
I'm going to agree with it even more.
Amen.
I'm going to stop being tired. I'm going to stop being busy. I'm going to stop having excuses.
Yes, amen.
I'm going to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I'm going to catch an airplane. I'm going to be on an airplane by 5:30. And I promise you, I will do this. I will have this. I'll touch heaven. I'll have time for the word. I'll have time for some manna. I have time for some being strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. I'll have time. And then on top of that, I've got the drive. Well, it's like I've got 30 minutes to drive here to park my car at the church. Then praise God, the Lyft driver is going to get really blessed. Because I'm not going to change my disposition over the Lyft driver. Lyft driver is not going to eclipse my relationship with God. I'm going to still have the high praises, the Kastapala Moshe Prakatani. Hallelujah. I'm not letting my circumstances dictate to me how I interact with the Almighty God. Hello.
Amen. Amen.
And I know I'm talking to you now.
Amen.
I know I'm all up in your business now.
Amen.
Your secret issues. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. Yeah. Hallelujah. 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 The Lord says, don't be a moron. No, that's what it says. It's a maru is the Greek word. It's an Arabic loan word, which is moron in Arabic. Maru in Greek. Moron in English. And the easy translation is unwise. The more acceptable would be foolish. A fool. Don't be stupid. It's also acceptable.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't be dumb no more. But be wise. You said, oh God. You said if anybody needs wisdom, ask and you give it. And he's like looking at you going, you got to be kidding me. He's telling us how to be wise again and again. To be wise is to know what God is doing and do it with him. To cooperate with his passion, to cooperate with his heart. He's not got a discipline. He's got a passion. It's something far greater than discipline. He's living life. He cares for people full of love and compassion. For everyone, not for a few. Don't be stupid, but be wise and understand what the will of the Lord is. Here it is. And nothing more important than the will of the Father. He says in Matthew 7:21, you're not coming in because you did the will. Matthew, 1 John 2:17. We know the world and the lust thereof pass away, but he that does the will of the Father abides forever. The will of the Father is absolutely essential. What is Father doing? What is his will? Daniel took a hold of Father's will. Every person in the Word of God who the greatness of God was manifested through, they just took a hold of God's will and started doing whatever it was he was doing, agreeing with him at the time for whatever purpose he had designed. That's what was going on in Acts chapter 4. That's what's going on tonight. Understand how to properly get drunk. Don't be drunk with wine. Wherein is debauchery. And by the way, you really want to know what that means? All you have to do is drive on the Southern California freeways, and you can see the sign that says, if you're driving buzzed, you're driving drunk. It's wisdom that most Christians don't even have. But don't be understand how to properly be drunk. Not with wine. Don't be buzzed either. Somebody said to me, well, I do this because I need to relax. You're an idiot. God called you to rest, not relax. There is a comfort. There is a peace. There is a refreshing. There is a joy. There is a strengthening that a wine can't give you. And now we got people sitting around in a circle smoking dope. It's crazy. It's getting completely wild out there, folks. And I'm not talking about the world. I wish I were. Because they're going to do that. We understand that. People in the church. They're stupid. Moron fits. Be filled with the Spirit. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Admonishing one another. Say, guys, we can do this. This is nations, nothing to take. Watch this. I'm going to tell you right now, we're going to walk in there, and this is what God's going to do. Fidel's paying for everything. Admonishing one another. No, you can take that giant's head. No, just stand there and speak to the mountain in a move. Tell that devil, go. Admonishing one another. Saying, go for it. God's vested you with all of his divine power and authority. Do it. Come back down. Don't pay any attention to their threats, to their edicts, to their signed documents. They're going to kill you. A lot of people are just threatened if they say they're going to fire you at the job or somebody might not like you. You didn't even advance to the level of being thrown to the lions yet. The consecration, the relationship hasn't been developed to that place, and it's a sad situation, but God loves you just the same. You're going to have to start praising him. You're going to have to start interacting with him. You're going to have to start speaking and prophesying and recognizing who he is. You know, I love that one little verse of scripture in Acts chapter 2. That's why prophecy and praise is so important to us. One little verse of scripture. They all heard in their own language them declaring the wonderful works of God. Hear me. Hear what the Holy Ghost is doing. Hear the activity of the Spirit. Hear how to begin to engage with what's happening in the realms of the supreme and divine authority. It's just recognizing what God is doing and doing it with them. Recognizing His greatness, recognizing His sovereignty, recognizing His majesty, recognizing His power that is supreme over all things. Not being threatened by anything that has been set against Him. It's His battle, not mine. I'm just engaged in doing what He's doing. Watch, you'll discover the power of God, the authority of God. Being filled with the Holy Ghost, being baptized in the Holy Ghost, same thing. Speaking to yourself. Here it is. Here it is, that thanksgiving again, that praise, the high praises of God again. Here it is, that prophecy again. Here it is. To covet, to prophesy. That wonderful divine expression of the Holy Ghost. He's poured out His Spirit upon some flesh, just a couple of people, a few folks from a few special denominations. It's special for a couple folks. Right from heaven. All flesh. He's poured out His Spirit upon all flesh so that you prophesy. What are you going to be doing when you prophesy? Declaring His wonderful works, His majesty, His glory, speaking, declaring His word, the word of Christ in you richly, speaking out these praises, these psalms, these hymns, these spiritual songs, singing, making melody in your heart, singing the new song tomorrow morning, dancing the dance, dancing the dance, dancing the dance, no dancing the dance. Special forces, they're out exercising. They're carrying away in a straitjacket. Because they're not exercising, right? Many Christians, special forces in God, we're praising. And it really isn't much more of an expression, not much more of a real involvement of their whole being. Let God move you. Let God move you. And God, the Holy Spirit, begin to move you. You know, I'm saying that by the Spirit of the Lord, so something will happen now. And I can see that some of you can respond, and some of you really don't know. You think I'm just still giving you information. I really haven't been giving you information. There's a supply of supernatural divine ability. God's word goes forth. God says, the word that goes forth out of my mouth shall not return unto me void, but shall accomplish those things which I purposed. Amen. But you have to allow it. His word that goes forth out of my mouth will not return unto him void. Will you will it? Will you allow it? Will you will it? Will you will it? Over there. Will you allow it? Right now, Naomi is too interested in her bottle. But we allow it. She's 2 years old. She's big. She's very bright. It's hard to remember that she's only 2 years old sometimes because she is so big and she is so bright. Very intelligent little girl. She, you know, she's captivated that I'm talking about it right now. But she is only two. And it's really important, dear people, that God has some growth in His church. Amen. Some maturation. Yes. Some greater skills that He wants to develop. Father's going to show you how. I promise you. Raphael, God's going to show you how. Manny, God's going to show you how. Aaron, God's going to show you how. Annalyn, God's going to show you how. Leslie, God's going to show you how. Zoe, God's going to show you how. Jacqueline, God's going to show you how. Alyssa, God's going to show you how. Debbie, God's going to show you how. Clara, God's going to show you how. You, every one of you, God's going to show you how. But you got to want these things more than anything else. It can't just be another thing along the shelf of all your purposes, because He'll have no other gods alongside of Him. No other important interest alongside of Him. No other things that you're going to serve. No other things that captivate your heart and your affections that really are meaningful to you. Holy Ghost, sweep over this room. Holy Ghost, sweep over this place. Father, I thank you for your assignments of greatness for the nations that rest upon the lives of every person that sits in this place tonight. Many that are watching by the web and by the YouTube. That army, O God, that mighty host that you raise up to go and execute your word, to execute your divine power and authority in the earth. Father, we thank you for the working of it right now. Everybody just stand with me. Just keep your hands lifted towards heaven. Father, Jesus is here. Papa's here. Oh, God's here. Paco Tarapasi. Sierra Mamana Sierra. Barabakataya Shiva. Oh, Mama Tepata Etos. Soap. Father says, look at the beauty of my covenant. Behold the nail prints in my hands and in my feet and in my side, my bruised and shattered body. Behold the authority of the Lamb. Behold the authority of the blood. Behold the authority of the cross and the plan of a new life that I ordained and called you forth into, to live not subject to the things that existed prior to this advent of greatness, but now to live in the realm of the family, to live in the realm of this divine majesty and power and splendor that Father fully vested you with the day that you called upon my name. No longer being subject to elements and circumstance and culture and the things that men demand of you, but to believe that which God has ordained, the one who fashioned it, the one who ordained it, the one who called it forth, who planned it and established it. Today, turn from the human ability. Turn from the circumstances that you've been taught. Turn from the lifestyle that you've been taught to respond to after the action and the manner and behavior of fearful and unredeemed man, and begin to live out the heavenly and the divine existence. Begin to live out the mission and the assignment of the ambassadorship of the Almighty God, of those who stand between death and life, the dead and the living, the ones who represent the Almighty, the one who created heaven and earth, and the sea, and everything that is in it. Give yourself passionately to those things which God has spoken, which is forever settled in heaven, and watch as his glorious plan begins to be unveiled through you. You listen to me. One of the biggest things that happens when you begin to praise God radically is the things that Satan imposes upon you in your disposition and in your thinking that he has no right to impose upon you. But until you begin to take a hold of heaven, it has an influence. It's like the prince and the power of the air, the god of this world. It's like the same kind of, as it were, general common temptation. It's Satan begins to place upon the affections and the thinking of men those things that hinder them from moving forward in divine majesty and strength and a revelation to see who God is and what He's given us to be. As you begin to praise Him, an authority rises up that is there vested in us through the new birth, that breaks off those influences, that breaks off those effects, that breaks off that just, as it were, almost common thing and influence that Satan is allowed. It's not that God has willed, it's that it's allowed. But you and I are not supposed to allow it. You hear me now? Listen to me. I want to be very specific with you so you understand. If I did not touch heaven, I would not have the same flow of the anointing in my life. If I did not touch heaven every day. I know from the dynamics of a personal relationship with the Lord, of praise and worship, of what happens, that every single day an influence, things that would affect my mind, my thinking, even my emotions, my behavior, my manner of disposition are broken. I can feel it broken. There is actually a manifestation of it being broken. What about people that go for weeks on end and never touch heaven? That's why they have the oppressed look on their face when they're in the meeting. That's why they can't touch heaven. That's why they can't seem to break out the mold that has been cast for them by the one who's the enemy of our soul. Listen, Paul frames it up like this. He says, look, you wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness. But he tells us, but you're vested with all power. Hello. This is bigger than tired. This is bigger than busy. You're vested with all power. Ephesians 6:10. Be strong in the strength of the Lord, the power of His might. And it takes every bit of that. And how does that come? And how does that flow? Being strengthened by the Spirit. Where is that? You allow, you let. How? By the Word of God dwelling in us richly. By being filled with the Spirit. By participating with laying hold on God in a relationship. Not a deliverance mentality. A relationship. And the dynamics of the relationship of being filled with the Spirit exposes what Satan was trying to impose on us. Listen to me. Understand the doctrine. Understand the doctrine of God. Understand the reality that fleshly lusts war against our souls. Understand that Satan is a rebel and he imposes upon us, or tries or attempts to impose upon us, things that will hinder us from flowing and moving with the Spirit of the Lord, moving in that which God ordained and fashioned us to be in these works and greater works and the dynamics of all the ministry of Jesus. It's got to come to a place where you get serious about God, to where that you don't allow yourself to be stunted anymore, held back anymore, dwarfed anymore. That it's discovered in your life purely out of a passion of love of heaven and love of all that Father has and all that Jesus is and all the Holy Ghost is doing, and in that place being filled with the Spirit, being baptized in the Holy Ghost, divine expressions, supernatural expressions that go beyond that which your throat can produce, that go beyond that which your energy, natural human energy level can supply. It becomes a divine flow, divine power, a divine supernatural thing. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You lay hold on that. Don't be shortchanged. Don't be shortchanged. That's what the Lord is saying. And three people got it. Because I heard three amens and one yep. I mean, two amens and one yep. Try it again. Try to grab a hold of, here's what the Lord is saying to you. Right now, God wants to empower people to take hold of being continually filled with the Spirit. You got it. You listen, discipline ain't gonna get it. Passion lays hold on it.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. That's right. Respond to the Holy Ghost. It's good. It takes you beyond information only into a receptivity. It really does. People just want to, so many times we just get stuck in, oh, well, I got more information now. Now, okay, what am I going to do that? What file do I put this one in? Hallelujah. Let God move on your life. Let Him baptize you. Let Him fill you. The Lord says, be filled with the Spirit. We say, yeah, that's what we're going to do tomorrow. No, now. So, listen. I'm going to give you an indicator. You know you've touched heaven when you can't stop a supernatural flow of psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. You know you've touched heaven. You know there's a flow. When you can't stop, you can't shut it down. You just lie. Are you with me?
Yes.
If there is no flow at all, you're not even close. And it's available to you. His Father's saying, come sit at the table.
Yes.
And Jesus is saying, come sit, have some.
Yes.
It's Dad saying, have breakfast. Come sit at the table. Have lunch. Come sit at the table. Have supper. Come sup with me. Hallelujah. When I heard that Wigglesworth, who ultimately got described the name Apostle of Faith because of the exploits and deeds, the power of God released in his life, got up every morning and danced around till the joy hit him. I said, well, that's what I'm going to do too. I'm going to imitate. And Father sees it. Father looks. Father's right there. He beholds. He says, look at this. Vicky, what's going on up here? There's somebody serious about the expressions, the divine expression of the Holy Ghost, of His love, of His joy, of His peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, you're going to take a hold of the power of the Almighty God tonight. To no longer allow dispositions in your life, behavior in your life that doesn't look like the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for the signs and the wonders and the miracles and the great exploits. I want to end tonight with saying what the Lord gave to me to say at the beginning. The Lord will make you 10,000 times more than you are. That is what He's going to do. He's going to make you 10,000 times more than you are. And even in those of you who sit at home and watch by web, the Lord's going to even do that for you. He's going to touch you so that you don't sit at home and watch by the web anymore. Hallelujah. 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 Everybody standing in this place tonight, you actually have the power and the authority to pray someone through to heaven. You don't know it. Many of you don't know it. But you have the power and the authority to pray someone through to heaven. Not once a year, but every week. To go and get them, to dote over them, to love on them. To bring them into the meeting, to give your life to them.
to see their lives saved. You know, there's a rabbinic saying that is valid, because it's not valid only in the context of which it's given, but the disposition results in what's said. He that wins a soul saves the world. He that saves a world, saves a soul or saves a life saves the world. He that wins souls is wise. Because ultimately, if you give yourself the disposition that you give yourself to winning someone, to saving a life, is a disposition that just gets bigger when that one life is saved. Now you want to do it again. Like, that was good. And now that you've done it again, you're getting hooked. And now that you've done it again, whoa, this is amazing. I had no idea I had this power. I thought I had to be on a platform. I thought I had to have a microphone. I thought I had 5 or 6 people sitting around a Bible study. I didn't realize that God wanted to begin it right here on the place of where I can touch someone under the realms of my influence. God has sent you into the workplace and every place you're going to go tomorrow because He designed a specific influence for you to have and people that are in that realm of your influence that you can reach. Yes. And if you don't lay hold on God, if your life isn't living out that which He's ordained and which He's willed and which He's fashioned, then you can never lay hold on the power that God has provided and supplied. It's described there in Acts chapter 4. You can't just let this message and this meeting be something that is about something that you're going to do in the future and is going to be happening with other people, and after all, the pastor's got to make it happen. This is something you got to grab a hold of that says, where does this fit into my situation? How am I going to submit myself to the reality that God has placed me right where I'm at, and I'm not going to come under the gag order and the mandate and the influence of the intimidation of whatever situation, whatever circumstance, whatever dynamics that's unique to my life. I recognize, wait a minute, I was placed there as the ambassador of Almighty God. Because He's got souls there that people are praying for and crying out to God for. I've walked up to people and say, your grandmother's been praying for you. Your parents are crying out to God. You knew God. You walked with God when you were a child. And then you begin to believe something else and you distant from the Lord. God will give you things like that, but it ain't going to start that way. He's going to start that way by you just being willing to go to them and say, listen, we got to deal with the fundamental reality of the condition of your soul. Because you're a forever living, existing being created for the purposes of God that were taken hostage and captive by powers of darkness. And God has made a way of escape for you. Whatever God fills your mouth with, and He'll fill you if you touch heaven. Because it's that same prophecy, it's that same declaration that comes right out of the realms of psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. It's the fellowship dimension of the flow of the Holy Ghost that begins now to be the ministry flow of the Holy Spirit. Same place, comes from the same place. Joy, love comes from the same place. Prophecy, word of knowledge come from the same place. Because I said, okay, here's what Father's will is to do. Stand and set it. I'm not sitting with a red light, you got a green light. Father's already said go. And you're saying, oh, I want to go. No, you're already gone. You're just wandering around like you haven't went. You may not have connected the dots yet. That, oh, I'm here by divine will. It's time for me to open my mouth and speak these words of life. There's a miracle for you right now. You can look at your life right now and base it on past experience and there prognosticate out of the realms of the imagination, your future. Or you can hear the word of God and see a whole new miraculous realm open up before you. I'm talking about a whole new miraculous realm. I don't care what you're doing, God wants to make it bigger. I don't care what you're doing, God wants to make it greater. Think about this. God turned Peter from a complete and total failure into a raging success inside of 1 hour. He had fished all night and caught nothing. Him and his partners, James and John, what a crew. Him, Andrew, James and John, the four mighty. Fished all night, caught nothing. But at the word of Jesus, at the obedience to the word of the Lord, whew, listen, suddenly they were a great success at their occupation. Can you hear? Suddenly they catch all this fish, fill their boat, fill James and John's boat, and now they're sinking. Their success is threatening their life. In an hour, in less than an hour, God can take you from failing where you said, well, I've tried and I labored and I worked and we've been going at it, but... Can you praise Him right now? Can you praise Him? Can you praise Him? Tonight, if you were a mute, if you were mute and you could not speak, you'd be thinking, oh God, if you could just loose my tongue that I might speak, I would praise You. Your tongue is loosed so that you can speak. So go ahead and do it now. Oh God, if I was no longer in prison to this or to that. If I had legs, if I had hands. If I had a mouth to sing, I'd sing. Oh God. Hallelujah. Well, I believe with all of my heart, I believe with all of my heart that every one of you can just live in the Holy, move of the Holy Ghost. You're going to live in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You're going to be continually filled with the Spirit. You're going to be continually filled with the things of heaven so that the Word of Christ dwells in you richly. It's no problem to speak the Word of God only when you're richly supplied with His Word. Everything that He's asked us to do, He's supplied us with the ability to do it. Hallelujah. Amen. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, the way things are shaping up, I won't be here much this next year. And so you're going to have to take a hold of God. You're going to have to take a hold of God. Because there's a lost and dying world out there that the Father is desperate to display His love and glory to. And so He's telling me I have to go. I have to do it. And I'm happy to do it. And I'm so excited about the Lord doing the same thing through you. If I ever show up and no one's here, as long as I know you're on the mission field somewhere. Not going and looking for another church that you can sit in. Now the Lord make you 10,000 times more. He's going to do that. And I'm going to be here. I'm going to be here as much as I can. I'm going to be here as many Sundays as I possibly can be. You know, we're just getting ready. It's so beautiful. I've been just over the past just 4 days, I've just watched the calendar filling up. Amazing things. It is so such a blessing to be passionately positioning yourself to be fully used by God in the full display of the life and ministry of Jesus. And I don't want anybody in here to do anything less. You have to plan for that. You have to position yourself for that. If you do not, you will never have it. You must plan for it. You must position yourself for it. You do what others have done, cooperate with God, go with the models,
what Father's done for one, he'll do for you. And I leave you out. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, come worship the Lord with your tithes, with your offerings. If anybody wants to give specially to the missions, there's cards to do so. The different things that are going on right now are hopefully evident on the card. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Bless them. Tell them that you love them. If there's anybody in here who wants prayer, we'll pray for you and with you. If there's anybody in this place that you're not certain that you're right with God, you need to get right tonight. Listen to me. Listen to me. I know of a person recently who had no idea that, and this course goes on by the thousands, the tens of thousands every day. Just person that I know personally had no idea that his life would come to an end the day before yesterday. There's still many things to do. There's still a big life to live. He's still relatively young. But on the way to the hospital, he started having a little problem breathing. On the way to the hospital, he died in the ambulance. You don't know how long you're going to be around. If you become real busy in the kingdom, you're probably going to stay around a long time because you're very needed. The Lord doesn't have extras. And I, like I said, one of my dear friends who was very busy in the kingdom, very fruitful in the kingdom, God doing great things to his life. He died instantly of a heart attack January the 3rd. You don't know how long you're going to be around. Today, you want to do everything. You want to give it all. Your response to the Lord needs to be with total abandonment. Not a mentality, well, in a year from now. That's unwise. Or I'm going to posture myself or position myself 5 years from now in my plan, in my 20-year plan. Ha, ha, ha. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the time to respond. Get it right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Once again, if you want prayer for anything, Jesus is here. Hallelujah. He's here to touch you. He's here to heal you, strengthen you.